when we pray here for some empowerment, of course that empowerment is the empowerment of our mind to convince ourselves to take advantage of all the good energy which comes towards us, because there has to be like reciprocation. There is receiving, accepting, transmitting, question, answer. There's a whole process goes on, which is amazing. Just like when you study the eye and the interaction with the mind of transmitting pictures and the meaningful things. So the ear, no? There's some incredible power operation going on. And all of that to create a transformation inside for us actually to advance, because that's what it's all about, purification, disposition, or like last night it was also mentioned, surrender. Surrender. I was surprised Shankaracharya spoke about surrender. He said, surrender means to surrender to something higher. So we have to surrender. And this word surrender is a very scary term, because they use it in war also. No? When are you going to surrender? Oh, we still keep killing you. Huh? Well, what is it all about? So when you apply that word to spirituality, well, and surrender, then you get a little bit nervous, no? Which way to turn now, no? And what to do and what not to do, no? So, anyhow, it was pretty interesting, and we heard a very important surrender yesterday, which came from Dr. Vandana Shiva. My God, I told her, you did it again, because she comes out with the same things, but always in a new face, always a new focus. Now, so wonderful, no? Economics, capitalism is a question of capital. Huh? How do you manage your capital? Huh? That blew my mind. The origin of that word, and then, yeah, that actually economics and ecology have the same root. So, spiritual economics, it's what, actually I was with Vandana Shiva in a course 10 years ago, and at that course we decided that we would make a boycott. A larger boycott organized. So I told her, I'll make it for you. I make the boycott page. And then I called it the Vandana Shiva boycott page. I put it up in the internet. And it was like listing up all the companies you shouldn't buy the food from. But then the lawyer called me. There's some implication coming there, and we don't want that, so we changed the name. Now it is the World Citizen Conscious, World Citizen Conscious Boycott page. You can still find it. We haven't updated it lately so well. But again and again we come back to the same, that we have to change our lifestyle. We have to change our consumerism attitude profoundly if we want to have a profound thing. Now, if a people say there's difficulty with energy or difficulty with resources, actually they're only wrong. It's only the squandering of the resources which makes the world so mad. If we simply make a decision, we have problem with energy, let's turn off the lights at night, okay? Huh? Let's turn them off. The whole planet is lit up. You can see it from satellite, what the world looks at night, and you go crazy now that your whole place is lit up. So and so many other suggestions. Of course, we are especially favoring the vegetarian option for contamination of the lands and so on and so on. But I, in one sense, I feel that this morning get together is of a very historic importance, because my friend Bruce Lipton, he has done simultaneously work which we have been doing in South America. And we just recently came to know about each other and the work we are doing. So he's actually being accepted by one of the North American tribes to be one of their tribes. You may call it, or also somebody who carries the load of the protection, of the guardianship of our sacred mother. Because anything we do in this world is just anyway, like Bruce says, it's given to me, it's not mine. So it's interesting, because that's what people say. They have something valuable to give. They say, this is mine, and I got it copyrighted, and if you want to have anything to do with it, you please go to the registration to see the commission. And you know, there's something is not so bona fide going on. So, that's Veda. Veda is truth. Like, a very interesting thing about Veda, the historians, the European knuckleheads, they were trying to figure out how old the Vedas are. So they go by what time of the history, which times of words appear. So if they find in the parallels that in the Vedas a word appears which apparently only appeared in the usage 1,700 years ago, then immediately they figure, so the scripture cannot be older than 1,700 years, and they find another one, or maybe 900 years, and then they, of course, they're not sure whether that item was not available there earlier. But in this way, they think very scientifically we define the age of a scripture. But it's a bogus approach, because the Vedas are very, very open. It's an open source. Divine enlightenment. That's for a Western mind. It's like only Linux tried to bring up such a concept into the modern thinking, you know? So that every time a sage, he rehearses a substance, he has to explain it in modern terminology, referring to modern phenomena, that immediately becomes included in the Veda, because the Veda is not, hey, wait, you got to talk like Lefebvre. If somebody said Lefebvre, we should only speak in Latin. If we stop speaking in Latin, we will stop being the original church, you know? So this kind of stuff, you know? But the Vedas are not. The Vedas can be translated into any language. The idea is only a worship of a substance, and that substance is the most real thing in the world. That's why it is alive. That's why it survives. That's why nobody can crush it and evaporate it like colonialists, they really like to do. They want to evaporate and pulverize everything which doesn't make money for them. So it's like clear-cut business, you know? And it's a military art that you conquer. Actually, it is embedded into our justice system. Even though most lawyers don't know it, most judges don't know it, but it's embedded in our justice system, just like neocolonialism is embedded in our educational system. That's why we cannot go ahead in the university. We are not really getting ahead. If some enlightened people appear there, they are looked at odd fellows, and like they somehow or other they push them to the side. And that is the law of conquest. that if you conquer somebody, then he and that what you conquer belongs to you. Doesn't matter what crime you committed to conquer, that is left under the table, and you are now the royal who whatever, you can crown yourself a king or something, or make yourself a president, and everybody says, oh yes, that's the new rule. So this law of conquest they have not taken out of the books. And because of this law of conquest, this might is right principle, that's what Donald Trump is writing on. Well, let me get my power and I show who conquers the world right now. So in this way, we have some profound lack of view. Actually, a secularist, he cannot see things. A fanatical fundamentalist, he also cannot see things. Only a follower of the Vedas, he can see things. Because he knows that he's allowed to see in his own way, appreciate in his own way, retain in his own way, transmit in his own way, but he must also agree to submit his own way to the sadhus' views. So the sadhus, they are like a counterbalance system. Therefore it is guru shastra sadhu vakya chitete koriya aikya. This is Veda. Let's analyze it. There's 4 checkpoints you have to go by. First thing, who taught it to you? Did you get it from somewhere? Did it come from some great thinker, authority, Vedic authority? Number 2, Guru Shastra. Is there any scriptural evidence to this? Has that been mentioned previously? Are there any histories which back up your idea? Okay, Guru Shastra. Now, sadhu. Are there people who believe that and who practice that and who confirm it and they say, yes, this is right, this is no fantasy? And then comes number 4, chitete koriya aikya. Does it give you inner heart satisfaction? Does it have a fulfilling? Does it give you that or not? If it doesn't give you that, then review again. Maybe you made a mistake somewhere, maybe you didn't get the whole picture, so review again. So this is what is Veda. And that's the freedom of thought. Everything besides Veda is actually tyranny in the realm of thought. And that's what the universities, what the governments, they're really good in that. Tyranny in the realm of thought. And they can do it. They have a capitalistic version, a communistic version, a speculative version, but many versions, but it's all the same. If you don't submit to my concept of what is knowledge and what's not knowledge, you have no chance in our society. You can be, you can go in the street and just say, I don't agree with the system. And if you're lucky, they don't kill you. Huh? In some systems, they don't even tolerate that, you know? They're sent to Siberia or to some places, no? They make you break rocks or something. So, the Vedas, yes, we hear the Vedas, the Puranas, we hear so incredible amounts of scriptures, you know? Rig Veda, wow. And can you think that? So one great scholar and writer, he was an Austrian, and his name was Walter Eidlitz. He said, how is it possible that the Vedic scriptures are so full of contradictions? There's so many things. One thing that's this, one thing that Shiva is the supreme, another Vishnu is the supreme, others say Shakti is supreme, and it just goes on and on and on and on. Sometimes the Veda says you worship the gods, the other says only fools worship the gods. Then the other says you should become one with Brahman, the other says Brahman is just like the compared to love is just like the water contained in the footprint of a calf towards an ocean. So the winners, they turn their heads left and right. What is all this about? What way I'm going to go? So then this Walter Eidlitz, he said he was so astonished by that. And then he found that in the Chaitanya explanation of the Vedas, the freedom, it is called Achinta Veda Veda Tattva. This Achinta Veda Veda Tattva has the power to harmonize everything into something really concise. It is called simultaneously one and difference of the different phenomena for the different situations, for the different mentalities, and it accommodates all what the Vedas have said. Like the Vedas speak about love. Love is the supreme. And that's emotionally very easy acceptable. But when you want to spell it out into practice, you don't know exactly what that means. Where do you put the love? Or does the love disappear? Like Shankaracharya said yesterday, when our deep sleep becomes the state of the awakening, then we reach the perfection. I don't know where's my love in my deep sleep. No, I think I miss it. Therefore, otherwise I may think, why not sleep forever? No, but there is some awakening. Anyhow, this is Achinta Veda Veda. It is accommodated in a simultaneous one and difference of the infinite. Because the infinite, just like in the infinite, there's male and female. Are you going to create an opposition between male and female? If you're a bloody fool, you may. But otherwise, they're to complement each other for reaching the perfection. So in this way, I also want to give my honor to the Vedic scriptures, the Vedic seers, who have given us the freedom, like the freedom to sit here and talk about the Vedas without opposition, but with possible enlightenment from further sages and further visionaries, because to apply this to our modern lifestyle and to give us a real enhancement and answers to the riddles of our mistaken attitude towards nature, for example, that is a need of the day. And here I pass the words to Bruce, that he will give us what the uplift movement is proposing and doing, because I just intuitively perceive it, but we want to know.
To start, there's a man, Bharat Mitra, who you've seen all the tea called Organic India, the tea company. He was a devotee of Papaji, and actually run the whole show, and he got the name Friend of India from Papaji. And when Papaji died, he wanted to provide something for India. This was after Bharat himself destroyed everything. So he organized an effort to...
That means it's not so long ago.
It's 15 years now.
15 years.
Okay. Yeah. And all these farmers who committed suicide to keep the family farm. So he went out and he wanted to introduce them to something like, people say organic farming, but it's really biodynamic farming. Organic farming is just the chemistry. Biodynamic is the environment and everything in the environment. So he wanted to show them and teach them, and most of the farmers looked at him and said, another Westerner, you know, we don't need any more Monsanto Westerners. So, but one farmer, just one farmer said, I'll do it, I have nothing to lose. And in the first year, his crops were the most amazing crops. And all of a sudden, all the other farmers around wanted to know. So they now have, I think, over 25,000, maybe 30,000 farms. And it's owned by the farmers, and the company, everybody splits, the farmers split, the workers split, the community, so it's not money for any individual.
It's a charity.
And it works.
It's a charity, sort of.
Well, it's a cooperation of everyone being part of one family. It's amazing to see the farmers. They love working because the people that pick their crops and all that, they get all the benefits as well. So it's lifting people, sarvodaya, lifting, uplifting. So he's been doing that, and everybody said it will never work. It was 15 years in the red. He had to keep paying 15 years to keep it moving. And 2 years ago, it went, it's now very profitable. And a lot of business people are looking, say, how can you make a profit by bringing everybody into the organization? And so he's showing them. He connected with me because I wrote a book called Spontaneous Evolution. And the nature of spontaneous evolution is we have a vision. Evolution takes a long, slow time. But no, there are jumps in evolution, almost like boom, just like something happens and then something big. So he was very excited by it. He brought me in, and then we started talking about the evolution of the planet and civilization. And he said, let's create a community to uplift people. And uplift stands for, and we use it, universal peace and love in a festival of transformation. So we, and he was at this
sounds
point
like Lord Chaitanya.
So he was living in Australia, only half the year in Australia, half in India, because his daughter, he wanted the daughter to go to school in Australia, so that's the reason why. So we organized a big presentation with speakers from spiritual speakers, economic speakers, agriculture speakers, science people, all kinds of musicians, everything. So that was the festival. And it was to raise consciousness of the people to what? We're all coming together and we have
excuse
to
me?
Please.
This is what we call Chusky Fest in South America.
Same thing?
Yes. The Chusky Fest is the musicians and the poets and the filmmakers,
yep.
They all go together and they celebrate with the public what has been discovered, what is the agriculturists, they are the heroes, so there is food there, this is, we have vegan demonstrations, how to make good stuff, wonderful to see, we
the
have
same
so,
thing.
Many, so many things.
So. We started in Australia, did three festivals, and they realized it doesn't get very big if you just do the festival in one place. So we stopped, and now we rebuild. And there's a website called Uplift Connect. And the whole idea is to connect people who are doing movements all over the world and all the groups and missions into one big growing organization. Okay. So Uplift would give the opportunity for you to have a page so that when people join from all over the world, they can see where in the world what's going on. And so Uplift is a dedication to the next level of evolution is not the evolution of a person. It's the evolution of a community of people. And so all of us are cells in the body of a forming organism called humanity. So we're just the cells. The whole thing is called humanity. And that's bringing everything, animals, plants, minerals, everything into one community. So the mission is to awaken the world, give an opportunity for people to connect all over the world into one thing. And so, and then now there'll be a big production, like a Hollywood production, to go around the cities of the world and be there and open the doors for people to experience what the new science and the old spiritualism and the new science is the same story.
Does that mean we're going to have you all over Latin America?
I know we're going. I don't know all over, but we're going. It's going to be a very, we're in the process of evolution, and this is why the world looks like it's falling apart. It has to fall apart before you can build the one that will work, as you know. So Donald Trump is people, you know, it's like, ah, and I look at it and go, he's destroying the structure of the United States. And this will make a tsunami across the world, and we will rebuild. But we may not rebel, for this is not the first time civilization has come to this point. We have been here before, and it didn't work each time. We talk about in Western, as you said, the Western historians, they got the whole thing wrong. They talk about civilization was like 5,000 BC, Tigris, Euphrates, Babylonia, and it's like, we now know in Turkey, a civilization they have dug up that was advanced and died 10,000 years ago. And the same thing, right at the same time of climate change. They were not able to sustain themselves because they could not grow any food anymore in Turkey. It turned into a desert instead of farms. And we are in the same place right now with the change. And the idea is either we come together or it will fall back down and then we start again the next time. So we are right now in, when you see all the crises, it's not an accident. They're all one crisis. We can't live on this planet the way we are living. That's the bottom. So Organic India Uplift is just an assist to bring awareness to people all over. And with a movement of we must come together or goodbye. I am so happy because the people get so much, all the workers are sharing in this. So
they're too happy. They bless all the, who have started off.
Yeah.
It is doing very well all over the world too.
All over, yeah.
Yes.
And as you said, everything grabs energy. And if you grow your food and you grow it in energy, then the food has energy.
It affects you also.
Is Ramdev Baba connected with that?
Yes.
No.
No? He grows a natural form of products. Organic India is totally certified. They go through the strict wavelengths not to add up anything wrong into that. But Ramdev is a natural form of growing up. So there is no certification for that. You can say it is natural, it is all right. But Organic India, you can just believe that, okay, you are having a good food, good thing.
Are you working, is Organic India working under the cotton?
They have started off with some kurta, something, but not too much into that.
No, but interesting.
Fab India
and Organic India are coming together. And Bharat Mitra, Fab India.
They are the base provider for the cotton, pure cotton, organic sort of a cotton. So they are everywhere, all over the world. Even in India, they are doing very well. Everywhere outside also people use their cotton. It's totally, comfortable, organic, and it's very soft.
Organic India has
BT cotton you're talking about?
No, Fab India.
Fab India.
So that is a different?
Yeah. Fab India is also started by an American, a foreigner.
This one?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. And Organic India, when they joined, was the one that said, don't use regular cotton anymore because it's poison.
Yeah.
And so he convinced the company.
He was being dragged back by lots of, from the Society of India that, you are grabbing or something. But now people are believing that he's doing a very good job.
Yeah. So the two have become organic. So Fab India is organic now. So.
They were organic for a very long time, but they were more into the clothing.
Yeah.
Organic India and the Fab India, they are coming together to come up with the organic cotton.
That was the big push.
Yeah.
No more poison.
So I can translate from that we are in an incredible communication gap. Because I'm a guy living in India for 40 years on and off, and I haven't even heard about Fab India. And Organic India now, I've not heard about it. In my villages, we don't talk about these products.
Every store here has Organic India Tulsi tea. Tulsi. They make all kinds of everything.
Okay, something like when it hasn't marked the difference, okay? Just like Uplift Connect is totally because we are not communicating. Or, let's say, the media is not in any way helpful for us to know what we are doing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we have the internet as a kind of a... But then where is our communication on the internet? Like Fab India is a corporation.
But they don't do the marketing like rest of the Pepsi and Colas. They, I think they don't go for that. It is through the word of mouth.
Natural. That's why it took 15 years for them, for Organic India to be profit, to make a profit for everyone. 15
they
years.
That people should use and then just go for that. They don't say come and use our product. You have to go, see, and then be there.
Well, like for example, just for our community, we are exporting lots of dresses for the devotees and so on. I've never got the chance that somebody say, hey, this is all this cotton, this is the organic, get this one. No? You go in the store and nobody tells you.
You can
nobody
just say
tells you.
30% expensive than the normal food.
It doesn't matter the price.
No, I'm just saying.
It doesn't matter the price. It's not promoted, it's not there.
No.
If I can have a choice of buying my organic cotton, I of course buy the organic cotton. It doesn't matter if it's a little more expensive.
And you know, in the natural form of whatever you eat, like, you know, in mustard oil, you can imagine how much the wrong things are there in the normal mustard oil. You can, if you are aware that it's there, then you will not consume that. But the 24 mantras are also organic product in India. So their mustard oil or all the rest of the oils are totally authentic. I mean, you can imagine 80% better than the normal oil. So that's it. But people are not, all the people are not the same like that. That's it. People are too much, as you said, people are going for more for the commercial way, more for the profitable way. You know?
The Khadi Bhavan was the Khadi Bhavan was the one outlet where you knew that the product is not going against the people.
Yes.
So that was I buying Khadi Bhavan for the last 40 years, you know.
Still people are buying from Khadi Bhavan, but Organic India has taken up a lot. And Fab India is too much into the market. Everything is too good. I mean, the moment you wear it, you can feel that there is a difference between the cotton what you are wearing and their cotton.
Could you maybe turn around?
Me? India story is a good story because that's when the looms, the machines came, and all the people were working with by hand. They lost all the jobs. And Fab India said, no, I want to save the art. So it only hired people who were doing handwork.
Right.
And now they have stores all over India, and the quality is
more expensive. But it's handmade, everything is handmade by the original artisans who make it.
No chemicals there, it's all by the vegetable chemicals and by the printing with the handmade, it's a natural form of
it. Yeah. So these two companies were trying to get back to the basic way of life on this planet and bringing up and supporting all the people who were doing original healthy work and make big company out of it.
That's the next one we have to study, how to link in with this. Now the Uplift Connect festivals that they took place in Australia.
Australia.
Of course, that's off the Trotten Pass for most.
That's why it's not doing it anymore, because it was a good idea, but it didn't go anywhere.
Well, we have started the Eco Yoga Festival in South America in many places. In some places like Bogota, the Eco Yoga Festival is monthly or bi-monthly and attracts 14,000 people, and people are really love it. I mean, it's like some spectacular event, and we have 100 stands there with ecological products. So it's like festively introducing all kinds of new ways. But again, my question is our communication. Where do we communicate?
UpliftConnect.com.
UpliftConnect.com.
UpliftConnect.
What this page offers to us?
What are
the highlights?
Every part of life, from healing to agriculture to yoga to every form of education, there's a page, and then you connect, and anybody in the world who is working in this area will be able to have a presence where you could see them and connect with them. And the whole idea is to take, everywhere in the world there's people making ecosystems,
yeah,
but they're not connected.
Right.
And until you connect them, their power's not there.
Mm-hmm.
So Uplift Connect is to, if we're all doing the same thing, we should be on the same page.
Is Uplift Connect connected with the transition movement?
The transition movement?
Yes. You haven't heard about that?
No.
Yeah, that's another big movement, the transition towns.
I've heard that, but I don't know much.
They're big. Yeah. They have entire towns changing over. Like in the Canary Islands, there's one transition island. They're going to try to get this whole island off the grid.
Yeah. Well, this is the mission. The mission statement is that humanity is the organism, and we have to come together and recognize every person on the planet is part of the same organism. And as you said, everyone has a little place here and a little place here. But until they come together, they don't have the power to change a world. So bringing them together is an evolution.
But just for sake of argument, to come together here with you is absolutely beautiful, but our people are $2,000 flight away from here in South America, where $2,000 means their house for their survival. They can't even dream of coming here.
No.
But we want to connect with them also.
Right. If they can get to access of a computer, every lecture that was done, all the festivals, every communicate, all of it is on video. You can stay at home and see a whole festival of all the speakers. So it's not just writing. It's like going to the festival.
It's
you can stay at home.
It's all on Uplift Connect.
Yes.
The speakers are you and?
Oh my gosh, from like Satish Kumar is part of the main thing. Vandana Shiva is leaders from all over the evolution. Leaders.
Vandana Shiva is funny because she's everywhere. She's in the soft food.
She's connecting.
She is in the United Nations of the Spirit.
Yeah, well, she's the most powerful woman on this, you know, in this planet. To
kind
bring
of,
this change.
Kind of looks like it.
Yeah, and she doesn't take no from people, you know?
No.
Yeah, so it's...
The Nobel Prize would get purified if it would give one to her.
True.
That's nice.
Most contaminated prize in the world.
Yeah, so that's why it says you can bring the festival to wherever you are. If you have a computer, you can have every talk, every lecture, all the performances, all available to anyone in the world for free.
Okay, so this is something we need. Our communication gap is very much that we are in the Spanish and Portuguese world, and this is the English world, and it's pretty hard, but we'll do it. We'll do it. The United Nations of the Spirit has an English site, so we have tried our best to communicate it, but we have not had that connection. Not that will be. So you went through the pages I gave you?
No, not last night. I've been running ever since. I have to sit down. I have a lecture too, you know. It's like, okay.
Okay. Because like you are connected with the natives of North America, in the Kiva movement, it's very interesting. The Kiva movement comes from the Lakotas.
Yes.
And the Lakotas, they gave this assignment to a Mexican abuelo, and Heriberto and his wife, they have taken the Kiva movement. They call it the roots of the world, the raíces de la tierra, roots of Mother Earth, roots of Mother Earth. And that movement is very charming, and they bring the grandfather and grandmothers of different cultures together. That is what we want to repeat in 2019 here in the Kumbh Mela,
yes,
with Muniji, where we're going to discuss this today, yeah, at noontime. I would invite you to come along with me to that meeting. But the Kiva, like say, okay, this connection is there, we have to do it in any way, but it has to be very much a localized place, a localized thing everywhere, because traveling is not even very ecological either. No,
destroy the planet as well.
It destroys the planet as well. So we have to really utilize this communication tool, which is nowadays available, to make people aware of what we have.
Yeah.
Like a Fab India. Is that promoted on
yes,
your page?
Yes. All of this. And we brought, I can't remember the tribe from Colombia who came to they came down from the mountains after being
Gokis.
The Koki. They were brought to Australia and part of Uplift. Yeah.
Really? So you're already connected with them on the other side. I'm in connection with the Kogis, but they never told me about that.
Oh, okay. Ask them.
Yeah, it's
they
large.
Came to Australia.
It's very large.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the indigenous chiefs, they move. If you invite them, pay their tickets, and they don't even want to make any, they don't earn anything on doing that, but they like to share what they have to share, and that is and that's what we are accumulating in the University of Ancient Wisdom. We are accumulating all these things to be able to communicate it to others. So that is also something which we want to connect with you. I don't know how much other things you have. Practically, Uplift Connect is the knowledge the University of Ancient Wisdom wants to communicate.
I mean, we sponsor the 13 indigenous grandmothers. That's sponsored by Organic India. So, they support they provide for them and send them places. Yeah. So, yeah.
So we have to talk with them about the Kiva in the Kumbh Mela.
That's why I wanted to put you on the Uplift Connect.
Yeah. I can see.
And then Puja Swamiji, of course, is a major connection with Uplift. This supports a lot of the program here right now.
Financially
supporting people to get them off the ground. Yeah. The company is not like old company, give me all the money. Is give the money and I give it back to
Uplift Connect is a corporation.
No, it's connected with Organic India, who started Uplift Connect. So, and Organic India has the money to provide. They support the Puja Swamiji whole organization too.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
It's not advertised here.
They didn't advertise. You don't see the name.
But usually, Puja Swami, look at the magazine. Is it in there where all the? Is it on the alliances and sponsorships?
I didn't know. I don't even look.
Look at the magazine. If the Organic India is there. Well, because advertising and communication is two different things.
See, one thing, organic products are very short in production, you know, so it's not for the masses, but our population is growing so big that the organic products are not being, you know, it's there.
Just like look on the brochure.
The brochure.
It's organic Indian. It's very much a part of the whole.
No, but there was another magazine, a magazine on this yoga festival. There was tons of alliances.
They, they have a like a. It looks like a candelabra.
I have a coffee, tea,
the cups.
Lotus cups.
It's a lotus kind of flower. And
this
that's their simple green one.
This magazine. Because there's so much stuff you don't realize it, you know?
Organic
and Fab India. India over here. Fab India, organic India.
Okay, okay. Yep. We have to do more homework. That's the problem. Because I thought there were companies that give some donation to Swamiji, but I didn't think they were part of some evolution of consciousness, you know?
The stem from Papaji teaching.
That's great. That's really great. What are you connected concretely to one?
You're starting outlets.
Yes,
organic only certified organic products
from organic India. And
there are other players also in the market now, but organic India is the old one.
You're about to collect.
Yeah, I like to do something back to the nature. Thank God to do that. Something at least I can do.
Now, another question. In this yoga festival,
yes.
Is there a concrete program to connect people and to wrap them into the activism?
I don't think there is anything. I haven't seen anything in that.
Well, that's what we do in the University of Ancient Wisdom. We actually give courses in activism. What people can do to be part of it. So now we have a lot of homework to do. To translate that stuff to Spanish and connect it into the physical reality of us. Of course, we have kind of counter similar things efforts there, but
just recently we had a major encounter with the Colombian government because they wanted to, US government made for the trade pact a condition that the seeds could not be reproduced, and all seeds would have to be certified by their enterprises. So the World Conscious Pact, which is working with us, the World Conscious Pact was founded with Vandana Shiva in Rio de Janeiro, that they made a movie about what's the background of the seeds business, and it started a farmer strike of 17 days. The whole country was broke. They brought out the army. They started killing some farmers, and so but the farmers did not go back. They kept, and after 17 days the president of the country had to declare that this law of the seed restriction was not. But what they did, they didn't cancel it, they postponed it, they pushed it in the back. And that's the law, that's the war going on right now. So, and while the young organic movement is just trying to take off, it's getting these people coming on top and want to crush them. So, but we have so many indigenous people there. But just like in India, you know what they did with the farmers. They called the chemical fertilizer medicine. You see, when the human beings get sick, so give them medicine. So if the plants are not so big as mine, give them medicine. Then they'll be doing good. And so the farmers said, oh, medicine. And they now urea has taken over India, no?
It's all like a mafia, all these pharmaceutical companies, these fertilizers, this government, they're all sort of a mafia. They sit together, they plan it, you know, just to grow their business. They don't see what's, is it good for the people to consume or not. That's the thing, you know. We can change ourselves, but what about that mafias, you know? They don't change themselves.
No, what to speak when they make laws,
yes,
making our activities.
These fertilizers, they make it. They are the business people. They just try to sell their products in masses. They want to make money out of them. So how they are going to do that? When they put that into the fields, they tell the farmer that this is a base thing. They don't tell this is a poison. That's how this is wrong, you know. It's all your in their thinking, in our thinking.
So many indigenous communities have been threatened,
yes,
by the invasionist techniques. And you know how that works? It works by the government going to the indigenous people and giving them the fertilizer for free.
Yes.
They give them everything for free. Oh, you're so nice. We have done so many wrong things to you. Now we will give you, look, this is good. The pests will go. This is good. This will go. And now we going there, like I was in a meeting with indigenous people up there in the Sierra Nevada of Colombia. And they were just having, they had the bag standing there. The government had brought to them, you know. And now I was telling them, this is the poison of our Western civilization. And the natives, they said, we want to know what the white man is doing, but we don't want to know it from them, from the government. So I said, then let's make this, this University of Ancient Wisdom, where we find and bring in all the things which we know, or what like people or the experts know, and let them let us share this openly with everybody. So that is the effort of the
yeah.
The wow.
Yeah, that's awesome work this organization is doing, at least, you know. But
of course, as soon as we do that, we are considered subversive. We are on the hot list of making people disappear, because these companies in South America, you know, I don't know how much you're aware of that, what is going on, but the land grabbers, in order to, it works like that. In New York, they say, palm oil is a good business. Okay, palm oil, good, good, good. How much business potential is there? Oh, we could sell a few billion metric tons of palm oil. So then they go computerized. Where does it grow? They go, Colombia, Ecuador, here. Then they go, oh, that's good. Let's call the Colombian guys, no? Hey, we need that land for palm oil. And they said, yeah, but this is all owned by little farmers. Yeah, well, you know, buy them out.
Whatever you want.
Get rid of them.
Yes.
Then what they do, then they create this false left-wing and right-wing armies, which are not left-wing and right-wing armies, they are Wall Street armies. They belong to the Wall Street bankers' interest. Then they go in there and they start shooting and kidnapping kids and making life so miserable, then they call it a red zone. When it becomes a red zone, then people don't buy there, or they can't sell it, they want to. So many people leave their lands even without selling it, and before you know it, then the bankers, hiddenly, they start buying up this land, so doing this, and it becomes all palm oil or chiquita or this United Fruit. That was Garcia Marquez, he documented how the Chiquita, the United Fruit, took over for the banana business all of Central America. They just screw anybody. And that's going on. And
yeah.
They're the mafia you are talking about.
It is all over the world. Not only you can say it's in a specific areas or
yeah,
in a specific country.
It's all over.
It's all over the world, you know. Now it has taken off all over the world. So, you know, maybe
this religion, this spirituality can change the bend of our thinking, you know. This changes us, you know. If you are towards the spirituality, if you think something is good in your heart, if you think something is good, then only you come towards the God, in towards the spirituality, you know. It changes a little bit towards that, you know. That's how you think of something good for the people.
This is one thing, Bruce, which I always tell our people. We have the weapon, which is we love to live with almost nothing. It's for us not an austerity, because of our lifestyle. We see a mountain and say, maybe a little cottage there, and maybe doing some agroforest cultivation, you know. So the Bhakti Yoga principle, the community there, the eco-village, that has this contents that you want to reduce, 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 but not like an artificial change. I mean, it all has its limitation, which are our limitations, but the principle is there. And like, for example, when people come to our place, I cannot imagine that 100 people stand there, because where's the 100 beds? Well, we don't have 100 beds. We sleep on the floor. Where's the 100 chairs? No, we seat 500 because we sit on the floor. And when you go to this, where do they cook? They have sometimes in the festivals, they have cooking pots. They are that big that the people have to walk in the sabji to measure, try to get that. So, and we're having a great fun doing that, you know. It's like, how many people do you cook? 10,000. Wow, you did that? Really? From this? And it's not a kitchen, it's just some fires. They make a hole in the ground, put the fire on. So this simple living, high thinking is for us embedded in our lifestyle. But of course, when we go to the modern city and so, then we also put gas for cooking, right? So we are flexible, but at the same time, we can perceive that it's possible.
We should use whatever is necessary for us, not to, you know, we are wise enough. All of us have been gifted by God with the wisdom. So we should use, you know, that cooking, electricity is very essential for us. We can't survive without. But if you use that electricity. Yeah, anything, you know, or a gas,
yeah.
Anything, whatever you use, you should use it in a way that it should not harm the nature.
Which is impossible.
Which is impossible, but still,
the natives have an answer for that.
Yeah, but
they call that payment. If you take something from nature,
you have to give back.
Yeah. And this giving back has to be proportionate to what you're taking. So this is exactly what is the payment. And you'll be surprised what's one of the main payments. You know what it is? Chanting the names of God. Chanting the names of God is a payment for some offenses we do against nature. No, we go there, we chant, then we can cut a tree for making a dwelling there, no? It's a very, and they have a science to it. And they're, well, they there, that means so many. In South America, we have still over 1,000 indigenous tribes being alive, some of them on the verge of extinction. But there's some of them are solid communities like, where's Aradia? Aradia, his father, he is an organizer of a university in the mountains of the Cauca region, which is between Ecuador and Colombia, all these indigenous people. His father organized their own independent education of their grid, totally independent from the colonialist education, and they built this up. So they are also with the University of Ancient Wisdom. So they are in whatever little feature there are, they're beautiful efforts. But as far as financing is concerned, like, it looks like India's more advanced. They're more, like, if you have big corporations who are already... I know when I was in Kumbh Mela, the people who visited Swamiji, they were big guys, but they were not from the organic movement.
Yeah, obviously, they will not.
Hmm?
They will not.
But they're helping him.
They have to help, you know?
Yes.
It's all is in
the That's very interesting, because that's where in him, people come together for the most contradicting lifestyles.
No? We can't be totally pure, because this is a time where you can't be totally, totally innocent and pure. But otherwise you can't survive. If the nature has become like that, that it's not possible at any instant. You can chant as much as you want. But that doesn't mean that in India there is a proverb that they say, okay, you, these all business people and all, they do all sort of these fertilizers and all. They use fertilizers for farming. And then if you go to temple and chant, it doesn't mean that it's helping you. I mean, end of the day, you are harming the masses of the people. And then you go and chant in the mandir. It's not a good thing. You should think what is good for you, you know? What is good for the masses? You can't just say, I'm chanting and I can purify myself with my sin. So it's a very different vision altogether now. It's a...
Please. I saw from your eyes that you are just on top of what we are talking.
Yeah. So I'll give you just my background. I've spent all my life with my mom. She's a philanthropist, and she has worked 25 years, more than 25 years of her life, serving the tribal communities in India. And we have worked for over 200 projects all across India, and in neighboring countries, Bangladesh, Indonesia. And 2008, we started a microfinance company, and we funded more than 20,000 rural women in India for their capital funding. And
connected with the guy from Bangladesh.
Yes, we learned. Yes, Dr. Mohammed Yunus.
I'm also connected with him.
So we learned the business from him, the how to conduct it in India, and so. 2011 and 12 was a moment when years were when microfinance started crashing because government intervened in between and some farmers committed suicide taking the name of the microfinance company, you know, putting the hard recovery pressures on them. While the truth was that they were pressured by the local money lenders who were charging few thousand percent interest rate annually. And that impacted our company and we went into huge losses. But these 4 or 5 years for me has been a great journey to understand what went wrong and why all the circle is where we are. And was that microfinancing in the country really impacting positively to the lives of people we were funding? So all these questions I've been pondering upon all these years. And what I found is that even the microfinance companies, more than 80% people were not there for, you know, positive impact. They were the money lenders. They thought that, you know, the money is pouring in this business. Let's get into this and charge high rate of interest from the poor people and let the cycle go on.
But how could have started with that on high interest? No poor farmer could start.
So now if you, I'll tell you the numbers. Today, if you go to Delhi, and you have vegetable market, a small vendor would borrow, let's say he bought some stuff, some vegetables on credit of 10% a day.
10%?
If he borrowed 100 rupees vegetable, he has to give 110 in the evening, which comes to around about 2,000 something percent annually. Interest rate if you calculate and
but just exactly the Bangladesh model is doing away with that how you call this in English when they overcharge interest rates,
usury.
the Bangladesh was doing away with that.
Yeah, I know. So that's why microfinance companies even if they are charging, let's say if you are a regular middle class person, you'll go to a walk to a bank, you'll get a 10% or 12% interest rate. Microfinance companies charge around about 26 to 28% from microfinance company charges around about 26 to 28% now by the legal guidelines. But before, when the guidelines were not there, they were charging 50%. So for them, compared to
annually,
yes. If you compare from 2000%.
Oh, and how does it make sense? I mean, I'm not a banker. 26%. The bank rates now are between 3 to 5% interest.
No, it's not in
interest.
No, it's very costly. Outside.
So I have run.
I'm not talking India. I'm talking outside.
It's not in India.
In India, it's like because I run a finance company. So how it used to work, we would borrow at 13 or 15% from bank, and then we would lend at 26 or 28% to the people on the ground, because we have an operating cost of 8 to 9%, only 1 to 2% we'll save annually. So and we would go door to door to give these loans, like in microfinance, and we will give them trainings, the rural women, get them together, make a group. So it was a huge cost that was involved. So 10% is the minimum operating cost that happens. So now the point is that if banks are funding us at 15%, then we have to have a margin of operating cost. And then only, and probably 1 to 2% profit margins, and that's how it is. And I've also met farmers to farmers why they're not moving on to organic movement, even though understanding that how important it is for their land. And they said that the moment we choose to go organic, it'll take 3 to 4 years for our land to get normalized, clear it off. And those 4 years, we won't make any profits, no food, no nothing. And there's no one to support them.
That's true.
They really, really want to go organic. Most of them, I've met them in the most, you know, highly impacted states in India are the northern states, Punjab, Haryana, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, where the most of the produce comes with pesticides. They really want to go organic. But point is that there's no one to support them in terms of how
financially, and
nobody's standing to take the responsibility of those
voters. Excuse me to interrupt you. I think, unfortunately, it's a little bit like Mahatma Gandhi says, that cow protection will only work if the government gives the full support to it.
Yes.
Otherwise, the mechanics don't work out. So I think for chemical farming to go organic, it's only possible if the government says, okay, let's do it systematically.
Yeah, now government is doing it. Now the Modi, this government is doing this sort of a thing for the farmers, for the low-income group.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
The thing is, as she's saying rightly, that they take it from the banks, they keep their margin in between, and then they put that to the poor farmers. So that poor farmers don't have anything to give it in back to them or to the bankers to show that they are going to pay back that money. That's how they suffer in between, by paying a more of interest. But now government is doing it. This is what is happening now. They have started off this motion that they are doing it, you know. So it's a good news for them.
Especially the sick.
Do you take bank loans?
No, I don't.
Do you take bank loans? I don't owe one penny to a bank. Everything I've done in my life without mixing with the bankers. When I hear 26 interest, yeah, that's South America. It's 26% interest a year. But that kills you.
Absolutely.
With that, I prefer to be a banker than to owe the bank 26% a year of some little capital, which people steal it, it's squandered, the things, that some crops die, and you go. So if that is the suicide motivation, that people just, they're screwed by this, and then it's terrible. So, but finish your point. What is it really what you are giving me now, or us?
So the point is, what you've started is so wonderful. This is the first time I'm hearing about the University of Ancient Wisdom that you shared. And
we need a finance advisor.
My advice
is don't take loans.
So I have this year only I decided that I am going to revitalize my finance company because I've got a license from Reserve Bank of India. But I will create a pool of investors who are ready to fund conscious mentors. And we will only fund, so if we, let's say we are funding a venture like Organic India and they are giving employment to those farmers or those people, that's far more better than we going and giving them a loan of 10,000 and charging them, you know, whatever interest rates. So there has to be way out of this and we have to take it on. And government is supportive, very much supportive right now, and we can take help, like a lot of support from whichever we want. The point is that we need to have strategized, streamlined things.
What's your name?
Harshita.
Harshita.
Have you heard the word Harsh? You know
happiness.
Harsh means happiness. And Harshita means the one
if
who spreads happiness.
I'm a professional, I'm a chartered accountant. As well as the farmer was.
My question to you was, do you have land?
No.
You don't farm.
Yeah.
I farm. I see the land and say, well, what can we do with them? He's a farmer. Huh? We don't work with loans. We work with simple life. We eat what we can produce or what we get. And we are not straight organic. You know why? Our land is yes, but people give food to us. People like, sometimes we get food because we do food distribution. And if when the people give us some food, we cannot say, hey, is it organic? So, like you say, we are not pure, no?
No, it's not like that. When you consume that with a pure heart, almost 80% that food also becomes pure, organic. That's my, you know, thinking. So we should.
That is the Pralat Maharaj philosophy.
Yeah, if you pray.
Yes. His father gave poison and he offered, my Lord, thank you for your
He became Pralat then. God came there to save him.
Yeah.
And you are doing a good base thing, that you are letting us know what is, you know, Vedas, what is this. This is how we'll be more pure. We'll do the base of the people for the society.
Yeah, I definitely believe in uplift and I believe in the beauty of every living beings. Just like Harshita, such a beautiful person. And who could imagine that this little girl is doing banking for helping people to have no money, you know. Actually, I just sent one person to Bangladesh to meet that Nobel Prize winner to get more information what they're doing. But like I said, the banks are difficult, you know.
Bankers are not suffering.
No.
They have too much of things to survive on. The entire check system and whatnot.
But you know, we should see both the sides. We just can't say we are only the right. The other person is also right. You know? That's why they may be doing that thing. But they have to think that it's visually they should understand we are not on the right path.
Haribol. Please come here, doctor.
It's just not about, it's not about right or wrong, it's just about that we need a world that is workable, it works for all.
Yes.
Yeah, point is this, and as long as we don't have a world which works for all, we're not done, our job is not done.
Absolutely.
Should work for you, it should work for me, it should work for the banker, it should work for her, it should work for him.
No, we don't. No. The whole concept of the finance, like this paper,
yes,
and this whole idea, it needs a big revision, you know?
But
what exactly that revision is like, I'm also not sure. I didn't come here just by making promises to some airlines. I had to pay money to get a ticket. So in a sense we are, but you see, my simple approach, let's convince everybody to go to vegetarian or vegan. That is the first
one.
First step. Now, next thing, let everybody convince to go organic on principle.
Oh, they can grow in the backyard.
That's part of it.
Yeah,
growing everywhere. It's like they did in Cuba.
Oh,
I tell you, nice. The Cuba and Venezuela, where I'm both active in those two countries. It is so horrible. There's no food. If you don't grow it yourself, you have nothing. And because the whole junk food industry collapsed in those countries, collapsed, it doesn't exist. Everybody's healthy. The people are not overweight.
No. They don't have food to
eat. They have no food, they just eat fruits, whatever they can get. The hospitals have no business. It is something, such a phenomena there, that we can see the austerity measures, they will not be easily accepted. Voluntarily not. Specifically, when you go in a supermarket with this little trolley and see 50,000 products into your eyes, you go out there like a zombie, you know? And then you have to pay with some strange card, no?
Yes.
Oh God, it's too much.
Interesting fact is when there's like a strike with doctors or a hospital, the people get healthier when they're on strike.
Yes, exactly. Three times it has been statistically.
Yes, absolutely.
We have lots of good voices and we have lots of good information. Now we have to create a tapestry, the love, the heart-to-heart knitting of all these connections. And become stronger and stronger and stronger, and that has to go fast.
Yeah.
Like you said, we need that evolution, jump start.
It's jumping now.
No?
That's why the crisis is making everybody, you can't live this way. What are you going to live tomorrow?
Yeah.
You can't do this anymore. What are you going to do?
Yeah. Yeah, the collapse is there. In Venezuela, we saw it. It was like when the petrol dollar fell down, all the thieves who had thieving there for a long time, no? They just had enough for stealing, but no more for distributing. They collapsed. The human, and here comes in the yoga. How will a person be freed of the cheating mentality, vipralipsha, and of this corruption? Egotism, which is like almost like a disease, you know, and which is can only be overcome if there's some sadhana, some real beautiful development, which again is very much enhanced by chanting and hearing. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Parasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Shakyam, Atmani Vedanam, the nine steps of devotional purification. Starts all by hearing. That's why we want to hear from you. Where are you stationed?
I'm in Delhi, New Delhi.
You're stationed in New Delhi. We are stationed in Vrindavan. So we are neighbors.
Yes.
So you please come and visit us to stay at our ashram, Vindakunja. It is in. Have you been to Vrindavan?
Many a times.
Many a times. Yes. And we don't know of each other yet.
Yes. Not yet.
Yes. We have a very large project for Vrindavan. We want to turn the Braj Mandal back into the village it used to be, for the sake of the economy of the local people, so that they can market this item of simple living, high thinking, but beautiful. Have you been to Chokidani? Give me the map. Chokidani in Jaipur, have you been there?
No, not Jaipur, There are two now.
Chokidani is the beautiful Rajasthani village put into a platform. So the idea of Braj Mandal, which has the capacity of a spiritual revival in India, it has so many beautiful things to offer. And for them, they're also suffering of all the chemicals, the same stuff is going on there, but they have this love. So we want to create in the main villages, like together with the village from them, but to have like a little, this alive village, what it used to be. So that when the people come there, they can go in that village and visit their temple and see their fields. And then, because tons of people go there, and they go there not to buy a Coca-Cola. That's what I get right now, no?
Yeah.
So we want to turn this all into back into the Lassi culture and the traditional way, traditional beauty, life there. And that has to be sponsored, at least to start it off. And this is like no oils we bring in. We make oils. We have the bullock going around pressing the oil there. And we are selling the fresh oil made right there to the people who come. And then people from Navdanya will come and buy the rest, which the tourists didn't buy, to take it to Delhi. This has to be organized by them. I'm kind of giving the idea, the artist, but there's good interest, and maybe we can also work together with this. If you have a connection, the Mr. Mahesh Sharma from the culture minister, he's very interested. Very much it depends on what happens in the UP election right now, because he cannot do much in Braj as long as another ruling party was there. But we're gonna do this anyway, it doesn't matter who rules.
Yes.
Give me one more of those. And give me one of the United Nations of the Spirit papers. And also, no, yes, it isn't. Give me the brush work. This is so amazing, this paper. This is the documentation, what happened when the United Nations of the Spirit were founded.
Excuse me, may I ask you a question?
Yes.
All right. Oh, gee.
Take this.
A business.
You have to speak a little louder.
I've been listening to everyone for a while now, and everything that has been spoken about the Organic India movement and going organic with everything that we use and consume, how do we make sure that we don't take away the local farmers? We don't take away their business. That's their only sole income. You know what I mean? God, then, like, how do we not take away their jobs while we are going organic? So, while we are going organic.
They cultivate the organism.
Right.
It's not being taken out something right. out of them. Like, to teach them to grow inorganic. That's it.
All right.
It's nothing. They'll be.
Well, one example, I have a friend in Bangalore. He's a well-to-do businessman, and he went to the local farmers in the Mysore area, and he has now 5,000 farmers producing organic. He buys all their stuff, packages in, and sells it in markets. Has been working.
This is all good for humanity and evolution. However, at the same time, we need to make sure that it doesn't go the other, you know, doesn't take the other path, doesn't give rise to commercialization. At the same time, how do we make it available to everyone? Because organic produce is a little higher,
yeah,
you know, in the market than your local, than your regular produce. So how do we make this available to everyone? You know, it doesn't matter whether you're rich, middle class, or poor. How do we make this available to everyone?
Grow your own.
That will, you know, at the same time,
at
you
least
got
that's
everyone.
That's a start.
That's a start, yeah.
You know, the answers to such questions like you are answering there. The problem is there's nobody to answer. No? So then it's like a mental blockage. Like, I don't know what their FAP is doing. I don't know their moral principles as from corporate point of view. But when people like them talk so highly about them, there must be something good inside.
I'll tell you what you have to use. Organic products are 40% higher than the normal food products. What to do it mainly, you know, in our kitchen and all, it's being cooked by the servant, you know, and you don't have to waste that. That's a precious food for you because you are paying a lot of hard work into that. You just can't just, if you want to eat two chapatis or two bread, you have to be a little more careful about it. You cannot afford to waste it or throw it, you know. So that's a one way, and the rest is like, it is a slow process. When you grow it, it comes in a very small quantity. That's how the GM crops have come up, because in our, see, there are so many, you know, there are plenty of people, population is just growing up and growing up. So for them, organic is not a solution, because with organic way, you can't feed the whole masses. Masses are not being fed up by the organic. Only thing is, everybody in some states or in some way, you know, you have to make it in a group, and then start growing that according to that, you know. So that's how it will take time.
What is your good name?
I'm Anjali.
Anjali.
Yes.
Anjali. Vandana Shiva is more.
I'm going to her, you know.
She says we can feed. When you say we cannot feed the masses organic, it's like throwing in the capitulation before we start.
She said she can feed, but why she's not feeding it? You tell me? She has the capacity to feed the whole India. Why she is not there in the market? She is in a situation.
We're talking here about the principle.
No.
We're not talking about individuals and not about their little efforts.
No, that's what I'm saying. It is very difficult to grow for the masses. That's how these GM crops have come up, because it's not easily possible for anyone. You know, you just ask Organic India. They are growing. They are the biggest player in the market. Still, they can't cope up with the whole of India, because it comes out in a very small quantity. Because you have to be very careful about the. See, when you are not using a pesticide, it means you are putting a natural manure into that. And still, there are so many, you know, infection is there. There are you know, so many rest of the other things are there. Water is not totally clean. So everything has to go in that crop. If the water is not clean, again the insects are going to go in that, you know, and that will harm the crop. So there are not a simple way you can just say, okay, we can grow the organ. There are so many ways, so many, you know, techniques to grow a proper organic way. And when it comes, it's mainly the 40% goes into a waste because it rotten up very fast. Because it's without the pest preservatives. You can't preserve it. You have to just consume it first. Like you just can't think, okay, we are doing it, we can eat it after 1 week or 10 days. No. Vegetables and all that will just go spoil within 3-4 days. So that's a thing, that's a minus point of organic things. So that's the thing you have to be
it's
very
careful. Never minus. That's health.
Health
is our wealth.
They have to think that this is a... See, everybody has a minus and a positive thing. See, we are full of with minus and a positive thing. We should just appreciate our negative things also. So, you know, that's a minus thing of organic food products. That we cannot just keep it for a longer time. You have to just consume it faster.
Yeah, if you get some nice fish genes into the tomatoes, then they last four weeks on your kitchen table without rotting.
So that's why we are going into the traditional way.
That's a fact, the fish genes they put into the tomatoes.
Yes,
that's good. So, people are being smart.
Now there are a lot of biofertilizers available, which we use growing, and even to preserve their organic things are also available, which you can preserve it for a longer period. It's not there. Point is, you have to do it anyway. You know, we can't survive with the GMOs anymore.
It will take some time, but it will happen. Everybody should be sincere with that. You know, you can eat little less, but you should just take a vow that okay, we can eat little less food. We don't have to waste. And we have to just, you know, be careful, like a precious thing. It's not a something like, you know, you cook, throw, and that's it.
We do actually do a lot to spread awareness, but the awareness doesn't really reach the masses completely. You understand, like Rishikesh, for example. Everyone comes here and, you know, you see most of them who are into yoga, spirituality, organic consumption, but the locals here, they don't do all of that.
That's the thing, you have to change the mindset of the people. That's only comes when you change the mindset of the people, that it is good for you, it is healthy for you, and you don't have to, they have to think that it is good, I have to, for me, I, the same thing with the people, isn't it, sir? Now you are aware of it, I think within 1 month you'll also be totally on the organic side, I'm sure. No?
I didn't follow your train of thought. I'll buy cotton cloths.
Government of course they are doing in their own way.
See, the best example is Organic India. That's what I'm saying. They are the best example. They have gone to the farmers themselves. They have made the groups and they have taken up their everything and made an Organic India.
Yeah.
See, that's how the
so in my case, as I was saying, we have a very big new farmers. I myself have enough land. There are new farmers. But it's still not much available, very honestly.
No, but initially if you think that you have to go for organic for 5 years, you are going to put your money into that.
Right, but that money is not become a problem yet. The problem is the land. Starting. As you said, very nice, no? The people here in Rishikesh. People come all the way from US, from Germany, from other countries for peace or for yoga or something. But the people who are living here, they never bother. I mean, I'm just giving examples, not that I'm just commenting on them. So for that, what we have to do is we can start the awareness. And once the awareness is there, then of course it's not that. I mean, this is my understanding.
That's how we are here with Swamiji, and we are just learning everything related to this.
Is it possible?
We have
a number or address. I would like to come and meet you. Is it possible?
Yes.
Please.
You supply him with God. Bruce, we opened a can of worms and we won't get them back into the can.
Yeah.
That's a saying for this type of situation.
Yes.
So, but these worms, they were tortured in this can while it's closed. Now it's open and they won't get back in there.
Yeah.
So now we have to expand our mind to accommodate.
Yeah.
And that brings us back to square one, communication.
Yes.
And that's why we are so grateful of this moment. Communication is linking up.
All the cells, all the human cells are linking into one, so everyone in the world can understand what's going on anywhere in the world at one time. This is the change. Like the organic movement, like I live in New Zealand, the farmers can't even keep up with the organic demand. People want it now so much that the farmers can't even produce enough organic food. And the more people that want organic food, the cheaper it is to make organic food.
Yes, absolutely.
And so I talk with the farmers and they say, we can't even keep up with the demand. Everybody wants organic food.
Do you live in New Zealand?
And California.
My God. That's why Australia.
Well, I was near Australia, but Australia is like little America, so I don't like it as New Zealand is its own place.
Yeah.
I can just add one thing.
I also do social service, as she was talking about finance. Finance is my country, chartered accountant, you can understand. I was in California for many years, and then finally I decided, why is this is to work hard here? Maybe arrange food and other things for me, then why? But of course, he was talking about the banks and all that. Still, I have an audit of the banks. Should be audit of the banks. So, I mean, as he was talking about, so I may be a little helpful. May not be 100%, but at least to some extent, being an authority on banks. And that's the MBO from Harvard.
I mean, you can imagine.
Yeah, so that's what.
You have an intellectual, spiritual responsibility.
I don't know, sir. I don't know what.
But no, I'm just.
And backside, my workshop is there. That I have given.
Yes, your website is here.
Yes. I do meditation. So I do meditation for myself.
And where's your.
I live in Uttar Pradesh because.
You're in UP?
Yes.
Where?
Lucknow.
Oh, you're from Lucknow? I was just there. We had a drama presentation in Lucknow.
Yes.
There was a program for authors and dramas.
Yes, yes.
There was a performance, and we also performed in front of the Gomti in there.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a very good connection with Lucknow.
Lucknow is home of organic India.
Pardon?
Lucknow is home.